Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to you all. I'd like to welcome Mr. Zulfikar Ghose, who needs no introduction, as they say, and our guest from England, Joe Dunthorne, and of course everybody knows the gentleman on my right, Salman Kureshi. We're going to start with a short discussion, which some have had concerns about because they just wanted a poetry reading, but I'm a little concerned about my own kind of state of angst and doubt about whether I, you know, should be writing poetry, whether poetry is relevant, and whether we're kind of, you know, talking to ourselves, addressing ourselves, and whether this is all sort of solipsistic stuff that we're doing. So I just thought a little bit of a chat about that wouldn't harm us. So I'd like to basically talk about the caption of the program was Poetry and Privilege, because the feeling was, my feeling and Salman's to a large extent, was that poetry has increasingly become esoteric and is the preserve of the very few, of and particularly the genteel, and not too many other people. So we were wondering whether we are relevant any longer, and whether whether or not we should in fact continue writing or not, or whether we, and if we do write, whether we should just write for ourselves. So basically, I'd like to ask our panelists to kind of, you know, think about this and say a few words, because I think it is relevant. I find myself growing increasingly alienated anyway. I'd like to ask Mr. Zulfikar Ghose to express him, to tell us something about this, about what he feels on the subject.
Well, thank you very much. We had a rather heated discussion earlier on. I've been carrying some poems, 10,000 miles from Texas, and I thought I would come and read them to you. But I was told I have to sit and talk. I hate talking, that's why I write poems. When I was born, the first 2 years of my life, I was completely silent. They didn't know what the matter was with me. I just didn't want to talk. And as a teenager, my family emigrated to England. And because the way we spoke English was different from the natives, they made fun of me at school, because I was the only brown boy in this school, grammar school, full of pink boys. So my revenge was to write better than they did. And so they had respect for what I wrote, not for what I spoke. It seems to me that once upon a time, art aspired to the condition of music, has often been quoted. Nowadays, art descends to the trivial, vulgar level of a talk show. And what are talk shows? Gossip. A whole bunch of opinionated people express platitudes and all kinds of banalities as though they were profound statements. Imbeciles parade themselves as though they were great philosophers. I don't really care for it. And to suggest that somehow to listen to poets reading their poems is boring, I don't believe that.
I'm sorry, may I cut in here for a moment?
No, I just want to finish the statement.
Sorry,
hold on.
It's okay, do
hold
that.
On. They're riveted here. I have seen, I'm going to drop a few names now. I've seen W.H. Auden wearing black glasses, stand up there, read, not read, but recite from memory. He always did it from memory. I've seen Pablo Neruda stand there and do a wonderful recitation. I've seen Francis Ponge read his prose poems as though he was reading a newspaper. But it was terrific, it was thrilling, it was exciting. The only time it is boring is when you have bad poets, because their poems are boring. So don't give me this nonsense about we have to talk and we have to have privilege, etc., etc. We don't.
Zulfikar, I don't think we need to banish thought from art. It was something I was expressing concern about, apropos fiction, and I feel the same is true of poetry, and writing and critiquing also, and talking about it, are also equally important to my way of thinking. He has finished. He said he has. Welcome to say more. He's very angry about having to talk. So why are you forcing him to go on?
I think I've expressed my anger.
He's expressed his concern. I'm going to ask Joe Dunthorne to say something on the subject. Joe, what do you feel on the subject?
Go ahead. My feeling is, like, I suppose I quite enjoy that poetry seems like a niche activity. It doesn't feel like poetry is destined to be a kind of pop music. You know, it's not going to be a kind of stadium-filling activity. So I don't feel uncomfortable with the idea of it being only relevant to a relatively small number of people. So I don't kind of see it as... It's probably at its natural level of popularity for me, and I like that it's a smallish interest.
Salman, we've discussed this subject before. Would you care to say something about it now?
From my point, very briefly, then, like somebody else, if they want to put their views, I think I take slight issue with Joe on one thing. Yes. Poetry is not today a stadium-filling activity. It has been in the past a stadium-filling activity in many parts of the world. And I would agree with Mr. Zulfikar Ghose when he said he'd rather hear or recite poetry than talk about it or listen to it. I would love nothing better than to do nothing but recite poetry. But I think there is a point here at which one says, this is becoming a very elitist world, the world of poetry, I mean. I think we have distanced ourselves over the years, we poets, from everybody except other poets, perhaps. Most people do try their hand at writing poetry. Just about everybody tries to write poetry at some point in their lives, in the back of an envelope or wherever. And then they grow up and they write prose, or they don't write at all. Do they listen to poetry? Do they read it? Yes, well, prose we have to read. We have to read the morning newspaper. We have to read the office files, whatever. We have to read the checks we're signing. But poetry we don't have to read, and probably the vast majority of people don't. And the small minority of us who do read or write poetry are becoming more and more distant from the rest. Is that a good or bad thing? I don't know. Because in the terms of evolution of the art itself, it's probably a good thing. Because then the art is not cluttered, as again, as Mr. Ghose says, it's not cluttered by needing to be populistic or appeal to everybody. It can just talk to other artists who are equally sophisticated, equally nuanced to understand what we're saying. Yes, but isn't that in the long run going to become very, very narrow? I have no answer to what I've just articulated. I'm just stating a very real question. It's a dilemma that I think does exist. It's like music. Anybody in this room knows the name of Beethoven? Yes, we all do, whether we've listened or not. How many know John Cage? How many have ever heard a Schoenberg concert? I notice blank faces around. Some of you probably have, and I'm not trying to be intellectually arrogant, far from it. All I'm saying is that music, classical music in the West, also evolved and evolved and evolved till it became attenuated. John Cage has recently written a piece of music which is being performed at the moment somewhere in Scotland. It's a piece that is expected to last 150 years in performance. Each note is played for something like 15 days. So there's this cathedral somewhere in Scotland, sorry, no, it's not in Scotland, I forget where it is, where a single note is being played for 14 or 15 days. And this is going to last 150 years. Now, this is tremendous art, please. It's what a magnificent evolution of art. Highly sophisticated, only for the elect. Who the hell's going to be around 150 years eating, sleeping, whatever, to listen to it? I think I've, you know, is this the direction art is going? Is painting going to end up in the as a blank canvas as it did with some? Is poetry going to end up with a blank page as it might?
It already has. It did a long time ago. We had a blank canvas in 1903, for God's sake. And are you talking the same John Cage as the one who died some 20 years ago?
Sorry, not John Cage. I beg your pardon. I wasn't talking about Cage.
You mentioned John Cage.
No. I mentioned John Cage, my era, the German composer, the German modernist, electronic music. Can you remember his name?
Weber.
No. Contemporary.
Anyway,
I beg your pardon. It wasn't Cage. You're absolutely right. It's a German composer. I can't recall his name. Come back to me in a minute.
You can have it out afterwards, surely, both of you.
No, but for God's sake, find out. I mean, these things have been done. Schoenberg was over 100 years ago, I think.
Yes.
And to be mentioning him as though he's something extraordinary now, this is all familiar territory.
I'm not mentioning, with respect, sir, I'm not mentioning someone extraordinary. I'm mentioning him as evolutionary statement.
But I take exception to the use of the word elitist, as though it's a bad word. I am proud to be an elitist. I don't ever want to be part of the mediocre sheep in this world. The reason why we are here is because we are something special. We have brains which have done something interesting, I hope. Otherwise, why are we here? We have to be elitist. And you won't make this charge against physicists, for example. I mean, you don't expect physicists to give a new paper and a whole stadium full of people applauding that physicist. It's nonsense. I mean, poetry, especially from the 20th century onwards, has been a very minority thing. We are doing it for ourselves. T.S. Eliot, 100 years ago, he said that, you know, you begin with a very small audience.
So it ends up being narcissistic above all, then.
There's another word, narcissistic.
Well, it is, isn't it?
It is narcissistic. It's all loaded.
Well, but you said it yourself, we do it for ourselves, that makes it narcissistic, surely. Anyway, let's move on to what you have been waiting for all along, and we all are, actually, marginal though we may feel, for the poetry reading itself. We are going to read out poems. And we thought that we would start by, I don't know if Khalid Ahmed is here. He's there. Okay, we thought we'd start with a poem by the late Tawfiq Rafat, because we do want to honor the poets who are not with us any longer, but who left their legacy. And I think it is important that they be with us, and they continue to be with us. And Mr. Khalid Ahmed is going to read out Tawfiq's poem.
Before the thrust of this liberating wind, whatever is not fixed has a place to go, strange northwards to the coniferous lands. And drunk with emotion, clothes on the washing line are raised above themselves. A flapping sheet turns a roof corner into a battlement. Gliding days are over. The birds are tossed sideways and back and lifted against their will. They must struggle to achieve direction. A welcome darkness descends. Harsh contours dissolve, lose their prosaic condition. All the sounds we have loved are restored. And now the rain. In sudden squalls it sweeps the street, and equally sudden are the naked boys paddling in the ditches. Alive, alive, everything is alive again. Savor the rain's coolness on lips and eyes. How madly the electric wire is swinging. From brown waters eddying around their hooves, the drenched trees rise and shake themselves, and summer ends in a flurry of drops.
Tremendous. Thank you, Simon. That was marvelously read. Really moving, really movingly read. That was wonderful. Thank you. How beautiful that was. excuse me. I want to ask Mr. Zulfiqar Ghose to read us some poetry.
This poem is about, perhaps not about, but to do with elitist people who go to the opera. And you have to be elitist, you have to be rich. And I love doing it. I'm not that rich, but I still love doing it. And one of the operas that is performed ad nauseum is called La Bohème by Puccini. I'm sick and tired of La Bohème by Puccini. I imagine everybody knows Bohème. If you don't, there is a character in it called Mimi. She conveniently loses a key, drops a key, and then a candle goes out so that she's obliged to come and meet the person who's going to fall in love with her, etc. And in the end, her hands are very cold because they're very poor students. And this poem is called No More Bohème, Please. Let's not have La Bohème again for another 200 years. Ditto for the Eroica Symphony, and ditto for Swan Lake, and ditto, ditto, ditto for Holt's Planets and Handel's Messiah. I really, really don't want to hear about Mimi's candle going out again. Let collective amnesia overtake humanity and work with satellites to jam the tunes still held dear by diehard fanatics from reaching the earth. It's the least digital technology can do. I really, really don't want to hear about Mimi dropping her key again. Let's pray to God that he blow his breath upon fundamentalists everywhere and in one miraculous moment convert them all to sheep. Let them, Lord, be shepherded to where they are their own and only audience with no one to listen to their bleating. I really, really don't want to hear about Mimi's frozen hands again. Thank you.
That was good. Thank you. That was a wonderful poem. I now want to ask Joe Dunthorne to read out some of his poetry.
Thank you. I'm going to read a poem, which I suppose is also about this kind of idea of high literature and low literature and the divide. There's a book called The Rings of Saturn by W.G. Sebald, which you may have heard of, extremely good book actually, but certainly regarded as the sort of book you might give to someone you're trying to impress with your highbrow readings. So it's a sestina as well, which you probably know involves six end words being repeated. Sestina for my friends. I know what my friends think of me because of the things they say. Joe, you are shiny and worthwhile and always thinking of others. I am not so great. I could name at least five people who are better overall. Here's one of my faults. I'm forever calculating how to present myself in any given situation. Calculating people give W.G. Zebald's Rings of Saturn as a gift and think that the person receiving the book will think better of them. After reading it, they will say, Joe, it was beautiful. I mean, he's like the great Gramps I never had. He even made Suffolk compelling. I always give Rings of Saturn as a gift, sometimes even to boys. Always is too much. I've given it twice, if I'm calculating honestly. Once to a girl who thought I was great for just over a month until she suspected, correctly, that I think I'm more interesting than her. If I say that the boy I gave it to was far better at football than me, then I think you understand. Better to be left for dead on the right wing, always knowing that the boy who embarrassed you, let's say his name's Luke, has this book in his bedroom. I'm calculating that he won't have sold it because he thinks, nay, hopes that one day he might read it, this great and clever book that was a gift from a friend who's not great at football, but by God, he's got a brain, and ultimately, it's better to have enormous thoughts than to be almost semi-pro. I think great people don't have these sorts of thoughts. I always keep my mauled copy somewhere half inconspicuous, calculating the spot where guests will see it, sure, but they will not say, I bet Joe put that there so I see it. More likely they'll say, huh, such a clever book, just lying there next to his football boots. It's great to know someone like Joe who's clever but doesn't rub your face in it. Calculating people are the worst in existence. This poem is better for its honesty. Even when I admit this stuff, my friends can always fall back on my honesty. He thinks too much, they think. We'd best not say anything about that Sestina. He'll always be great to us, better than great, more like excellent, or this is what I'm calculating.
Thank you, that was splendid. Thank you very much, Joe Dunthorne. I now want to ask Shima to read out a poem by Zeba Hafiz. Would you come to the rostrum? Shima Kirmani.
I'd like to say that the only reason why I'm reading this poem is because Salman said Ziba is not able to come. So.
But you read so magnificently.
Well, I'm sure the poet can read better than I can.
No, but she'll read the next one.
It's called Mesopotamia. In this devastation, I see it. Birthplace of prophets. Saints' insignia defaced. War returns, bodies, rivers of blood. The small, resolute band, Karbala, and the ravages of Genghis Khan. This century's precision, sword stroke, bombs, igniting the skies. The muezzin's call to prayer winnowed through Baghdad's palms. Another dawn.
Thank you very much. Superb. Thank you very much. I now want to ask Sherbanu Zafir Iqbal to read out a poem by Maki Kureshi, the late Maki Kureshi, who was one of our very special poets, a really marvelous poet. You're reading out the cerebral palsy.
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Maki was my English professor at college. I feel very privileged to be reading her poem. It's called For a Victim of Cerebral Palsy. How shall we label you? Rare? Extinct? You cannot speak or lift your head, but understand three languages, I'm told, and your eyes speak, snapping like an ill-used pet. Yes, we cajole, exaggerate our smiles as we pack your ramshackle bones into a chair. We are kind and trained to do what's best. Troubled. Why are you so snarling, alive? Look how tenderly we preserve leopard and tiger, till their eyes are bland. Exiled, a demon weeps inside your skull, making you dumb with unspeakable hate. I cannot think of any kind of hell, but it takes your shape.
Whew. Terrific. Gosh. Yeah. Absolutely wonderfully read. Thank you. That was magnificent. And what a great poem it is. Yeah, absolutely splendid. Now I'll ask Maki Qureshi's daughter, Shirin Harun, to come and read out one of her poems.
This poem is called Earthworm. I'm sure I won't be able to better share Banu's reading. She did a beautiful job on my mother's poem, but I shall do my best.
Tremendous.
One has to take the experience of him on faith alone, for he himself is most comfortable in shadow. His whole existence, an act of vanishing adroitly underground, leaving just the faintest trace of loam. Such solitude, composure, it keeps him blind, down in his province of sources, stones, and dirt, where one surmises him to be at work, gnawing or growing, though in his mouth the taste remains the same, equally indistinct. Or stranger still, that he, with all his inborn craft, who turns the soil, who labors so long at the root, evinces not the least desire to see the flower.
Thank you very much. Khalid Ahmed, would you care to come and read out something by Alamgir Hashmi?
Karachi stopover. The man's arm swings in the air like a whip. I see the air bleed. I hear it cry and shout for help. This crack of bone and tear of flesh that pain receives as tribute to its power must rule here. I seek its face among faces, lean, aloof, now lost suddenly like a summer splash on a green lawn. I say, friend, are you here? A petty criminal, they say, who's out in tropical heat and must prove someone's idea of justice. There's no forgetting pain for your subtle face. This country's the There's no forgetting pain for your subtle face. This country's the definition. My luggage in the taxi sweats. The airport is empty. Its planes gone to pray till 4 p.m. while bombs in the lockers snore. Not even a visit by God will change it.
A moderator is supposed to read their poetry. Yes, should I forget about myself?
You're supposed to be a poet.
No, I mean, are moderators supposed to read their poems? I don't think they are. But anyway.
Moderately,
indeed. One second, I'll just be with you. Called Eerie, E-Y-R-I-E, in other words. The dark death's angel's wings with their iridescent fish scale undersides quiver as they're folded in, eyes squinny as through a visor, narrowing to a cold, long, lashless stare. Dispirited but intent, the bird takes the sun where he can find it, hunched above a parapet on boughs which are really the bars of a television antenna. Just a few feet off, the world he's in retreat from falls away to, high hanging in the trees, a late winter afternoon glow. It's girders and cats, the day's inclusive reverie. And then returns to where, in pinched disdain, he guards a pristine hunger. We know that such a one as this would scarcely cavil if occasion offered. And some slight movement beckoned, some small life throbbed among the shrubs below, or may perhaps even one day have swooped to earth, but not to kill, to drop decorously, as one might a napkin, having unseamed it with sartorial skill, a refined mouse skin by a roadside. Thank you. Now, Salman Kureshi will read us a poem.
I will. Yeah, of course. Yeah. What do you mean? You will. What does that mean?
Sorry. The warning that must accompany this is that my poems tend to be interminably long. This is in five parts. Please bear with me. It's called Death of a Prominent Citizen. Part one, obsequies. He was honored by the city he'd loved and made his home. Three former chief secretaries, the entire staff of the museum, relatives, acquaintances, children, grandchildren, commemorated his obsequies. Newspapers fattened a feature page with all he'd accomplished as executor of government plans, administrator of districts. But most of all, as a trustee of reliquaries, regent of ancient remains. The textures of time, defaced statues, desiccated manuscripts, patinaed masonry, these had most excited his ardor, aroused his care. These he'd collected, cherished, preserved for the citizenry as hooks and links to a discontinuous heritage. He'd reached back into time, pulling out skeins and swatches and derelict exquisite clumps into the light of our ordinary day. For this, he was most remembered. Part two, Requiem. Honor him. Himself inevitably, irreversibly altered by time. The count of years pleated the textures of his skin, dimmed his eyes and filled them with salt moisture, pulled down sags of flesh from his fine bones. Dilettante antiquarian, gifted collector who sifted the alluvial layers of our pasts, unearthing motives, meaning out of ruins, who turned a personal passion to public heritage. Honor him. Remember him for all he did and all that perhaps he retreated from doing. Join the lean rows of those who mourned him. Few have ventured all he had. or so failed short of mastery. Honor him. Part 3, Vigil. In the shifting breezes of an August night, trunks of moon-silvered poplar undulate between jasmine shrubs in the park, near where, tangled in tubes, pin-cushioned with needles, wired into circuitries of sensors, monitors, he scrabbles for breath on a hospital bed. Sit by me as I keep this nighttime vigil. More parent than son now, I regard the dwindled form on the bed, the thin feet. Part 4, after the funeral. The next day brought silence as his mourners conferred him to the dust of his plains. In a darkness fragrant with leaves, they returned, wordless, between gravestones and trunks of oak, mulberry. Recalled as they filed from the unspeaking grave, his gift of conversation that twined the listener in webs of words, ideas, thoughts. Recollected the effulgence of an overarching mind, spirit, remembered his passions of love, of rage. Some few of us wept at how those passions had been stilled in a derelict body. Mourned the transformation of wit to whines of complaint, punctuating long silences. We'd observed his mind turn towards and away somewhere, as in stricken muteness he contemplated the pain, the gracelessness of his ordeal. Part 5, Elegy. For 3 years, locked in silence, he'd explored the structures of his success and unsuccess. He had conjured in his head continuing arcs of moments, events, places, people, relived within himself his many triumphs and also his omissions and fallings short. His failure to find in his books mastery of the universe, his two disordered marriages and desolate, angered children. Pity him not his months of suffering. The dead need no pity. Honor instead the fastidiousness of his long, exacting re-examination. There is nothing further. Judgment is completed. Honor him.
Thank you, Salman. Thank you very much, Salman. I will now ask Muin Faruqi to come and read out a poem.
This poem is called Partition. In that year, they left the old house, taking the odor of clothes and souls. We replaced the trees and crows and planted fresh birth sounds and sleep sounds. We changed nameplates. We changed the street. Even now, when the pot boils on the old stove, making tinny sounds, it is the noise of the morning women restless and the men demanding bread. There is cement on sandstone, concrete on the ground where the sleeping desert once swam. But from the cracks in the wall, the house speaks. There is breath coming from the black loam around the rose bush. The ants speak. The wind that slaps the west wall speaks. Shadows of bones walk in the night. The house bears its soul with each monsoon drop on the windowsill.
I want to ask Mr. Zulfiqar Ghose to please read out some more poetry.
There's one more poem?
Whatever you want to, maybe with a so short time, what can you do?
Okay, here's one short poem. It's called Image in Karachi. Last year when I was here, driving back to the airport, I just happened to see this. It's very short.
You don't have to make it extra short. You can do it a longer poem.
Okay. I'm being incited now. Image in Karachi. On a mosque, just below the minaret, silhouetted against the declining sun, perched on a loudspeaker that broadcast a call to prayer, absorbed in looking down at what it could consume next, a vulture. And there's a poem called A Woman Bathing. Renoir, Degas, Bonnard all painted her, an arm raised, a towel in her hand, an uplifted breast glowing abundant, her flesh radiant as if flush with desire. Her image, observed from an adjoining bedroom, a recurring fantasy in the male eye, the mistress of elaborate charms, serenely meditative in that still and seemingly vulnerable moment. Her newly cleansed body lustrous as if she performed a ritual ablution prior to a ceremonious surrender. But her pensive, coldly self-absorbed look holds in fierce tension nature's determined design. Let the male dream of conquest. She will fill the washed womb of creation with his blood. I'll read one more. Okay, that's it. This is from last year. And it's all to do with birds and loudspeakers and stuff. It's called Silent Birds. It was the month I flew to Pakistan. The crows were quiet in Lahore. I read that in the other city of my childhood, Bombay, fewer vultures were returning to the Parsi Tower of Silence. Birds the world over took on a troubled look, as if some unexplained failure confused flight patterns and rendered hazardous the autopilot of instinct. Noisy at sunrise and sunset, parakeets in a green cloud above the mango tree, grown silent now, without a voice in what to expect next. Bombs suddenly exploded at the World Performing Arts Festival in Lahore. My family home shook as if in an earthquake. A day later, news came from Bombay of a terrorist attack on the Taj Hotel right opposite the Gateway of India. I sat in the garden of the old family home. A bulbul hopped across the lawn and stopped seeing me and flew away. A crow alighted on the garden wall, opened its beak out of habit, but uttered no sound. I looked for parrots, saw none. There were two eagles, though, floating in the sooty pollutants drifting up the sky, gliding noiselessly in a wide circle. But one banked away on memory's programmed flight path to descend on the dusty eucalyptus tree in the garden. From that very same perch, generations of eagles at sunset had cried aloud and pierced the cacophony of crows, a cry shrill yet musical, an exultation. Not even a chicken's peep now from the eagle's open beak, its throat throbbing in a nervous pulsation among the dust-laden leaves. Then the fifth daily eruption in the sky. From the 8 loudspeakers on the local mosque's minarets, the priest shrilly called the faithful to prayer as if nothing had happened. nothing at all, absolutely nothing. Oh God, thank you.
Joe Dunthorne, I would be grateful if you'd read something now.
Okay. I have been in the unfortunate position of dreaming about poetry and other poets, and this came from a dream I had. It's called Workshop Dream. All poets lived in one low-rise resort. Sleepwalking, I climbed across the white balconies to Sean O'Brien's apartment. I expected him to be angry, but he wasn't. He said I was not the first poet to arrive this way. Inside, Kenneth Koch was cooking breakfast, a Faber editor was applying After Sun, and there was a woman I'd not read. We walked through the quadrant in O'Brien's slipstream, noticing everything worth noticing, the blanched undersides of leaves, George Surtees's towel, the memory of wet feet on stone. We stepped onto the beach. The water made the sound, cliché, cliché, cliché. We shooed away the avant-garde who sold necklaces made from shattered windscreen glass. Tiny grains of sand, I added. Sean, our windbreak, shook his head and pointed out to sea, but there was nothing. He advised us to look again, and this time, sure enough, on the surface in the troughs between waves, a huge flock of addenda.
Very good.
A very subtle rhythm, wonderful cadences. Thank you, Joe. Khalid, would you care to read something more by Tawfiq? Have you got another poem? Khalid Ahmed, do you have another poem by Tawfiq? Could you possibly read one?
No, I'm not finished. Because we have enough time now.
Poem for Fawzia. Having come to these fields, this pond, to brood on early death, I remain to praise the lavishness of nature. Other seasons may be niggardly, not autumn. It gives and takes with abandon. Into its slot, shishams will one by one insert all their green coins while the wind riffles its currency of rice. Dear lovely girl, you write the rainbow of our prayers and give us the strength to face the continuing chill. Sorry. Dear lovely girl, you write the rainbow of our prayers and give us strength to face the coming chill. Shadows lengthen softly. In the seepage, reeds and the nurse-like lilies stand rooted in coolness. An annulled wild berry tree tests the water by trailing a broken digit there. Now, acceptance settles in the mind with the nicety of a dragonfly. And even as I fling up my arms in an excess of pity and love, the pebble of my presence breaks the porcelain herons into blurred flight.
Thank you very much indeed, another wonderful friend. We don't have very much time, but I would like Zeba Hafiz, to read out a poem on Iraq.
These two poems, The Blood of Iraq and Mesopotamia, soon after the invasion of Iraq. And at that time, I was affiliated with the University of California, San Francisco, and there's a reference to it over here. The Blood of Iraq. Blare of music, a roadside cafe with its Starbucks coffee looks down at the University of California. Bodies half bare, cold and alone, salt water remains wet on my hand. The features of a human, eyes of a wolf, turn to remake history.
Thank you, that's very good. Thank you, Zeba, thank you so much. I'm afraid we have to end the program. We've got to call it a day. I'm very grateful to all of you for having been here with us and having taken time to come and join us. Marginal or otherwise, I'm very grateful to Zulfikar Ghose for having attended this semi-poetry reading. And Joe Dunthorne, thank you very much for having joined us today. It was a pleasure having you, and Zulfikar Ghose. And Salman, thank you very much all for bearing with us and being with us. Thank you, and I hope to meet you again next year. Thank you.
SB, you were terrific.
Oh, thank you.
What a great reading.